Why is it so tough to get to Venus? And how long would it take us to get there? Going from point A to point B on Earth's surface is easy. Despite whatever obstacles there may be, you just need to follow a direction, and sooner or later, you'll get there. Calculating the travel duration becomes pretty straightforward by simply dividing the distance by the average speed. It might seem even easier in space, where there are no obstacles, rivers to cross, or mountains to navigate. You just go straight and there you go. Unfortunately, we're about to see that things aren't that simple. Space is only seemingly an endless prairie where you can freely run in any direction at any speed. In space, there are invisible stakes that mark mandatory paths. We don't see them, but the void surrounding us is effectively curved by the masses of the planets themselves, and especially by the predominant mass of the Sun. With one more complication, the planets move, so the pattern of navigable paths is constantly changing. Thus, over the years, it became clear that to direct a probe towards its target, it would be necessary to calculate launch windows, transfer orbits, deceleration maneuvers, and gravity compensation. And all within the limits of a technology that currently only offers the possibility of using chemical propulsion engines. In a couple of previous videos, we examined the challenges to overcome and the travel times to reach Mercury and Mars. In this one, we'll talk about Venus, which has been of great interest for scientific missions since the early days of the solar system exploration. Getting there, and in the shortest time possible, has always been imperative for spacefaring nations and researchers. But what's the shortest possible time? In this case too, as we've done for Mars and Mercury, it can be useful to examine the flight times of space missions that have taken place over the last 60 years. And in this video, made as usual for you by the Insane Curiosity channel, we'll try to take a closer look at the matter. Going to the Moon, which is about 400,000 kilometers away, typically takes only 3 days. How long will it take to go to Venus, considering it's 100 times farther than the Moon? A simplistic answer would say it would take about 300 days, which isn't too far from the truth. But if a simple proportion were really valid, going to Jupiter, which is almost 2,000 times farther, would cost us a whopping 15 years. Yet the Voyager missions took just over 2 years. Or that to go to Pluto, which is currently more than 10,000 times farther than the Moon, we should expect a journey of almost a century, while the New Horizons got there in just 15 years. These are just a couple of examples, but enough to understand that there's much more at play in calculating mission flight times. To understand more, let's examine the time taken in past missions. The first mission aimed at Venus was Venera 1 in 1961. The Soviet probe, launched at full throttle, reached Venus in 97 days. However, it performed a flyby at too high a speed and then got lost in orbit around the Sun. The following year, NASA's Mariner 2 also flew past the planet, but more cautiously, taking 115 days. In 1990, NASA's Magellan entered orbit around Venus after a journey of a whopping 463 days, penalized by the use of a low-power engine following program cancellations after the Challenger shuttle disaster in 1986. In 2006, ESA's Venus Express reached Venus's orbit in 153 days, using the main engine to reduce speed and be captured by Venusian gravity. So it seems to range from 3 to 5 months. But why does a journey to Venus take so long? To understand this, we first need to visualize the fact that Venus and Earth orbit the Sun in nearly circular and concentric orbits, spaced apart by 0.27667 astronomical units, or 41.4 million kilometers. And as deduced from Kepler's third law, Venus orbits the Sun at an average speed of 35 kilometers per second, significantly faster than our planet, which is 29.8 kilometers per second. So much so that while it takes Earth a year to complete a revolution, Venus only needs 0.615 years, or just over 7 months. So we can imagine Earth and Venus as two cyclists on a track, with the inner one, Venus, faster than the outer one, Earth. One of the many questions that arise in these cases is, how often does the inner cyclist, Venus, catch up with and overtake the outer one, Earth? The calculation is straightforward, and it tells us that the inner cyclist, in this case Venus, will reach Earth, or rather align with it along the line connecting them with the Sun, every 584 days, also known as the synodic period, a period in which Venus will reach the minimum distance, as mentioned before, of 41 million kilometers and then move away from it. Alright, now we have all the elements to move on to the most important question. What are the optimal trajectories, orbits, to reach Venus? At first glance, one might say, well, let's wait until we're at the minimum distance and then shoot a probe straight towards it. No, unfortunately, things in space, as we've already mentioned, don't work like that. It would be like shooting an arrow at a moving target from a moving vehicle. By the time the arrow reaches its target, the target would have moved, so we'd miss it by a long shot. To hit the bullseye, the archer would have to aim where the target will be when the arrow arrives, not where it is when the arrow is shot. Okay, but interplanetary space is a bit different from a shooting range. In space, the distances involved are immensely larger, and spacecraft, as well as planets, move primarily under the influence of the Sun's gravity. And there's no escaping it. The universal law of gravitation and the laws of dynamics tells us that a spacecraft will necessarily, once the initial thrust is exhausted, follow an elliptical trajectory. And since the orbits of planets are more or less pronounced ellipses, all we have to do is find an elliptical orbit that, starting from Earth, then intersects Venus's orbit at the right moment when Venus is in that vicinity. Hang on a sec, guys, before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you'll help us to make products of even higher quality. So, what should be done to send a probe from Earth to Venus? Celestial mechanics and budget constraints provide us with an answer. What needs to be done is to search for a transfer orbit that is energetically efficient, minimizing propellant consumption. The reason is twofold. Firstly, the propellant itself costs, and secondly, a greater amount of propellant to carry increases the overall mass of the rocket to be put into orbit, further raising costs and reducing launch velocity. At this point, some of you may object, but do we really need to carry so much fuel to go to Venus? Isn't the Sun's gravitational force enough? Indeed. The second determinant in interplanetary flight is precisely the distinction between inner and outer planets. As strange as it may seem, though, heading towards the Sun by being attracted by its strong gravity is not an advantage at all. It's okay only if you're satisfied with quick flybys, but if you want to enter orbit around a planet like Mercury or Venus, you have only two options: either decelerate with retro rockets to counteract the Sun's gravity, or lose speed by performing flybys with nearby planets. In the first case, you'll need a huge amount of fuel. In the second, travel times and distances will increase immensely. To better understand the situation, you should imagine having to throw an iron ball towards a pair of spherical magnets, one very large, the Sun, and one much smaller, Venus, in such a way as to capture the ball with the smaller magnet without it being first caught by the predominant magnetic field of the larger one. Quite difficult, isn't it? That's precisely why, among all the planets in our solar system, Venus is, much after Mercury, the most challenging to reach, despite being quite close to Earth. The same thing happens for the outer planets, but in reverse. In this case, one must overcome the Sun's gravity, which tends to slow down the probe, and flybys with other planets are used to acquire more energy, and therefore more velocity. It was the German engineer Walter Hohmann who first studied, in 1925, the trajectories that allow one to pass from one planetary orbit to another. Based on these studies, it was established that the simplest transfer orbits are ellipses tangent to both the departure and arrival orbits. In the case of Venus, starting from the low orbit, a first deceleration is applied to the vehicle, reducing the velocity from 29.79 kilometers per second, which is Earth's orbital velocity, but also the vehicle's, to 27.32 kilometers per second. To put it on an elliptical orbit whose major axis is equal to the Sun of the radii of the Earth's and Venus's orbits, which here we assume to be circular for simplicity. Of course, as we approach the Sun, the probe will tend to accelerate, and towards the arrival will risk being ahead of the encounter with the planet. At this point, we'll need to ignite the retro rockets to slow down, with a velocity reduction of 2.71 kilometers per second, and then begin to orbit around it. Once in orbit, we can calmly consider how to descend onto the surface of Venus. But can we deduce the duration of the journey from this configuration? Absolutely. Thanks to the geometric property of the Hohmann orbit we just mentioned, the length of the major axis of the ellipse is equal to the sum of the radii of the Earth's and Venus's orbits, we can easily calculate that this length is 1.7233 astronomical units. From this, using Kepler's third law, it's then straightforward to calculate that to traverse the arc of the ellipse leading from the Earth to Venus, which is 2.69 astronomical units long, equal to 402 million kilometers, it takes 0.4 years, which is 146.1 days. This maneuver is the one that involves the lowest initial velocity. The Hohmann orbit indeed has the advantage of fully exploiting, as if it were a springboard, Earth's orbital velocity of 30 kilometers per second, which is not possible on a journey to the Moon, as it shares the same orbital motion with Earth. Even though given a distance between the orbits of the two planets of only 78 million kilometers, the spacecraft will actually have to travel 402 million. The feeling remains that 146 days of travel are really a lot, especially in the case of a crewed mission. Could we do it in less than 146 days? Certainly. Do you know how long it would take a probe to reach Venus's orbit simply by letting it all fall towards the Sun from any point in Earth's orbit? Only 41 days. The thing is, the probe would have to start from a condition where its orbital velocity is practically zero. This is impossible because any probe launched from Earth possesses both the velocity due to the rocket's power and Earth's orbital velocity, which is about 30 kilometers per second. Now, to drop the probe straight towards the Sun, it would be necessary to zero out this velocity, giving it an initial push of equal value but opposite sign, which would be practically impossible with current launch technologies. To drastically shorten the flight time, we would therefore have to press the accelerator to the maximum. But as we've already mentioned, it would require an unreasonable amount of fuel, and this additional mass would in turn require more propellant to be carried into orbit and accelerated. This state of affairs, unfortunately, will last until we abandon chemical propulsion and begin to use ion or nuclear propulsion. Moreover, it's worth considering that it's not possible to arbitrarily increase the speed of a vehicle destined not to fly past a planet, but to land on its surface. Spacecraft, in fact, must arrive slowly enough to execute orbital insertion maneuvers and not simply pass by the intended destination. And this means arriving fast and then consuming a lot of fuel to slow down with the retro rockets, which is further complicated on a path as astronomically short as the one between Earth and Venus. So how else could we slow down the increasingly fast descent of the probe towards the Sun's gravitational well without resorting to extremely heavy fuel reserves? Simple. Well, relatively speaking. We send the spacecraft on a journey around the solar system so that we can exploit the powerful gravitational attraction of the other planets it encounters on its way to its destination. Depending on how the spacecraft approaches the moving planet, it can increase or decrease its speed relative to the Sun. This allows us to give or take orbital energy to or from the planet and change the spacecraft's velocity without using fuel. This maneuver, known as a gravitational assist maneuver, flyby, swingby, or gravitational slingshot, allows us to explore a wide range of objects throughout the solar system with a limited fuel budget. If we want to visit the distant outer planets and minor bodies, we can take some extra energy from Mars or Jupiter. If we want to visit Venus, however, we must give some to the other inner planets by flying past them one or more times. As a result, using close flybys to help a spacecraft arrive at Venus slowly enough to enter orbit is excellent for reducing the need for fuel, but it makes the journey to the small planet a very, very long one. In the end, the time required to reach Venus depends on several factors, including the launch window, trajectory, and mission objectives. With current technologies, we'll unfortunately have to resign ourselves to long flight times comparable to those to Mars, which is almost twice as far as its closest approach. These are the whims of celestial mechanics. Patience is required.